Could we wait a minute here? Because I'm getting in too deep. The thing is, see, is we're not that kind of close anymore. The way we used to be. And a friendship's like a garden. You have to water it and tend it and care about it. And you know what? I want it back.
Welcome to Putting It Together, the podcast that goes through the entire body of work of Stephen Sondheim, show by show and song by song. My name is Kyle Marshall, your self-described Sondheim expert. You get to be witness to a bit of a performance in this week's episode, with Franklin and Shepard Inc. being this hugely involved acting piece with percussive elements that the actor has to provide. I am trying my best to perform this song in the optimal way possible. But you, dear listener, are going to have to choose on whether or not I did a good enough job. I don't really want to belabor the point here too much. I do have a new guest here this week with Richard Brown, who delivers some great insight into this song. So we might as well jump right in to discussing Franklin Shepard Inc.
He goes, and I go. And soon we're humming along. And that's called writing a song. Then he goes. And I go. And the phone goes.
Richard Brown, thank you so much for joining me here today.
It's a pleasure. I'm a big fan of the show.
Oh, thank you so much. I mean, I think we should jump right in to talking about, like, your history with theater, with Broadway. Like, what caused you to fall in love with it in the first place?
I have to tell you that as far as Stephen Sondheim is concerned, I'm a bit of a Johnny come lately. Mm-hmm. I grew up not anywhere near Broadway, but my mother was a huge fan of the classic sort of 50s and 60s shows. And so in my household, we had an old-fashioned wooden console turntable with one of those spindles where the records would drop. And all the time, my mother was playing Music Man, Camelot. We had Annie. And we also had Gypsy and West Side Story. And I knew those cast albums pretty well. But it wasn't really till later in my life that I kind of bumped into Stephen Sondheim and into that whole cult and culture.
Now, metaphorically bumped into Stephen Sondheim or actually bumped into him?
Oh, not him personally.
No, okay.
I got to a point in my life back in the 2000s. I was in my mid-30s and kind of a lonely, broke period. And there was an AM radio station that I listened to all the time back when we used to listen to the radio that played The Great American Songbook. On Sunday afternoons, they played a couple hours. They had a Broadway show. I got very into that at the time. And also that what was happening at the time was around the time of the 2006 Company cast with Raul Esparza.
Right. Yeah.
And also the End of the Woods movie. And so Stephen Sondheim at that point was getting a lot of airtime on this radio show. And I didn't really know either of those two shows. And so then I started going down the rabbit hole of figuring out what Company was all about and listening to that cast album, and then eventually the video of that John Doyle directed show. Mm-hmm. And I was really hooked into it. Yeah, all my life I had grown up with going to community productions of big Broadway shows and being in some community productions of Broadway shows, although I'm not really an actor, nor do I have any real talent. It wasn't until I got to Company that I discovered that the commercial and the avant-garde could really come together. I went to a college where I went to see, it was a small liberal arts college, and all the plays were sort of Brecht and Beckett and, you know, little black box type theater shows. And to experience Company as the minimalist stage, the weird thing in that production with all the actors playing musical instruments, it was a real eye-opener for me of what theater could be. So Company was kind of my gateway drug in my mid-30s. And from that point, I started looking into all the other film productions of Sondheim shows and going to see them where I could find them.
I mean, being in your mid-30s, what a great entry point into the Sondheim universe with a musical that is literally wrestling with the fact that someone is turning 35.
I was Bobby.
Yeah, you were Bobby at that point.
Maybe we've all been Bobby at some point.
Do you feel that that's influenced your writing? Because I know that you're a writer yourself. Like, do you feel like Sondheim or even just more generally theater has helped you in your writing career?
It helps me in the sense that I pay a lot of attention to structure and storytelling, to what works in a book and what doesn't. Merrily, We Roll Along is such a fascinating piece because it's highly flawed, but I also can't stop trying to figure out what works and what doesn't work in my head.
Yeah, I mean, that's the big question here this season. Just to answer that right now from you, is it a failure? Like, take out like the commercial out of the equation. Just as a piece of musical theater, like, is it a failure for you?
Well, the musical part is a huge success. It's so full of surprises. And you're always sort of discovering little things that Sondheim has slipped in yes. here or there. So from that point of view, I absolutely love the show. It's the book and really the end of the book that ultimately I have to judge is just not successful. I think that I see the ending from one of two ways. Either it divides up the audience between the young audience and the older audience and gives kind of conflicting messages depending on where you are in your life. If you're a slightly older person, I'm not sure what it's trying to tell you to do, but we can talk more about that.
Sure.
You know, obviously for younger people, the message is don't let this happen to you. Follow your dreams, treasure your friendships, that sort of thing. But if it's not just that it's unsuccessful, there's the other thing which I been giving a lot of thought to, which is the last song really, really cynical, where we have the characters up on the rooftop and singing a pretty positive song together, but the characters themselves, they're at the beginning of the story at this point because of the structure of the show, and the characters, adults, are never given an opportunity for any kind of resolution in regard to their friendships or their values or their priorities. It's really missing something at the end. I don't want to jump ahead too far, but since you sort of brought it up first, I don't know if this is considered a hot take. I like the bookends in the original version of the show. The Hills of Tomorrow pieces at the beginning and the end, and the idea that this whole thing is a progressive flashback. And then when we get to the end, we're kind of reminded of where we started from a literary point of view. I find that much more satisfying than the way that the revised show is left at the end.
Yeah, so I've already kind of stated my case probably on the podcast up to this point. And once again, I'll point to the fact that we've recorded all these episodes out of order. So sometimes I don't know what I've said yet. But I think overall, where I come down is that the revised, I'll call it the 1985 version, I think is more successful kind of in the middle pieces. But the original 1981 version, I agree with you, I think works a little bit better with those bookends. I don't think either of them are like a home run necessarily. And I've really been grappling with this. Have you by any chance ever read the actual Kaufman and Hart play that it's based on?
Yes, I have it right here. I don't know if you can see it, but I've got six plays by Kaufman and Hart and I have read it.
So this is maybe my hot take out of the whole thing. I read that yesterday as we're recording this, and I didn't actually really like it all that much. I think there's some interesting things, but I think it actually has the same problem the musical has, is like, what am I supposed to actually take away from this? Is there something that it's, I guess, more succinctly trying to communicate? I think further into Sondheim's book of lyrics here, he mentions a conversation he had with Joseph Mankiewicz. Basically, what we're shown here is like, absolutely, it's a tragedy that he's pushed some of these people away. But at the beginning of the story slash end of the story, he's a rich, successful man who just has another hit play and is dating a really young woman. It's like, oh my God, like this huge, awful thing he's fallen himself into, right? It's like this huge tragedy he's discovered upon himself. He kind of has gotten what everyone kind of wants at the end of the day. It's not Citizen Kane, where we see the very end where he's pushed everyone away. He's the sad, lonely man sitting in bed by himself looking at snow globes. Like, I think you're right. There needs to be something else, especially at the end, to wrap it up or flash back to the present day to be like, okay, like, look at what we're A, trying to communicate, but also B, look at the actual tragedy that we're throwing in front of you.
Yeah, I agree. The book is, the play, the Kaufman Hart play is much more focused on, it's not Frank in the play. I can't think of what the character's name, but
Richard.
It's Richard in the play. Richard and Gussie.
Althea, in the play.
Okay. But yeah, there, the really follows is trying to set up kind of a romance, a lifetime romance between the two of them, I think, as opposed to what was brought to us on the stage version, which is more about friendship and youth and finding your way.
In that original play, what I think the most shocking thing to me was his original wife, Helen, is kind of awful in the original play. Like, I guess that kind of answers the question of, like, you prefer the original, like the 1981 production, though, overall?
I'd like to see it. You know, there's a terrible, some sort of terrible bootleg video that's out there. On YouTube, which I have sat through. I think some of the play is actually missing from the video.
Yeah, you don't see, like, the beginning of Act 2.
Yeah, and it's hard, especially with the kind of the ensemble pieces, to kind of see what's actually going on. So it would be awesome to see somebody put on a production of the original musical show somewhere. I have seen a revival on Broadway, and I've seen some of the other complete videos of the revised version that are out there. But I would only say again that I would venture that there are things about the original that I think are worth taking a closer look at. The recovering them might make the whole show better on the whole.
What about the either musical themes or actual, like, literary themes? What are the things that stand out to you about the show?
Well, again, the thing that surprises me the most when people either talk about or write about this show is that they tend to focus on Frank and Frank's women. Every time I see a synopsis of Merrily We Roll Along, it's a whole thing about Mary's unrequited love for Frank, which is a part of the show. But really, the central drama of this is Frank and Charlie.
Yeah.
And you might agree or disagree with me that that the central drama here is a homoerotic relationship between these two, and Charlie's obsession with Frank and trying to get him back to a certain intimacy and closeness that they once had. It just surprises me always when I see people talking, as I said, people talking about this show, that relationship is really never discussed.
I tend to agree, I think. I think that the more compelling part of this entire show is that central relationship with Mary kind of being the go-between between the two of them. But I think there is something special there about them, whether you want to have that reading of some sort of, like, unrequited homoerotic love affair. I think that there's enough in there for it. I actually just recently watched this video. I don't know if you're familiar with the movie Heat.
Michael
Pacino. Mann movie.
I've seen it. Go ahead.
There's that reading that a lot of people have too. It's like this criminal and this cop who circle each other for that entire movie, and the last thing they do is literally, like, touch hands with one another and walk, and as one, like, drifts into the shadows. Like, there is a very much a reading that you can have within that movie, even though that's not explicitly what it's about. Merrily, I think, has this similar thing to it, which is, I think it's fine to have that reading of it's just merely a friendship, but I think throughout the show you see that it's deeper than just that, of just friendship. I think that there's a creative aspect to it. There's a love aspect to it. I think that there's a whole lot of stuff that's wrapped up into this central duo.
Yeah, I think also there's an analogy going on here between the central, what I would call the centrally intimate story between the two men and the mistress, if it doesn't sound too sexist to say that, which is money and fame. Frank, he has several wives. There are several other women that he's romantically involved with in this story. But the one that really sort of seduces him away from Charlie is his desire to be rich and famous, or rich and happy. And I just think that that's an interesting part that gets left behind. They're literally there's a scene where Charlie tells, at least in the revised version, where Charlie tells Frank, you should leave Gussie.
Yeah.
The song when they're all outside of the courthouse, Now You Know, where Charlie calls Frank's divorce the best thing that could ever have happened. I don't want to overread into it, but it's an under-discussed aspect of this show.
Well, the song that we are talking about here is Franklin Shepard, Inc. This is a very much a Charlie-centric song. I do want to have a bit of a conversation around just the character of Charlie Kringas, but before we jump into that, like, right before this, like, what is leading up into this song, Franklin Shepard, Inc.?
Okay. In the original version of this show, what we have is a scene at a restaurant where Mary has tried to engineer a reunion between these three old friends, and Frank snubs Charlie.
Right.
And there's a bit of dialogue in this where he goes into a whole thing about a third world village somewhere where once somebody becomes persona non grata, then everyone in the village pretends like that person never lived and doesn't exist anymore. And then we go from, again, we're talking about the original version, the original stage version of this. So at that point, we don't know why it is really that Charlie is getting the brush off from Frank. Then we go back in time to 1973, and we're in this TV studio. In the original version, it looks like some kind of live documentary or something like that is being made.
Yeah, it's like this is a very different thing between whatever version that you're watching, because yeah, the original, it's like just one interviewer. It does feel like it's more like a sit down documentary type of thing.
Right.
Whereas definitely in the newer version, it's like, I don't know, like your Good Morning America type of thing, like a Sunday or like a weekday morning show that they're both a part of.
Anyway, what's happened right at the entry point of this song is that Frank has been offered a big movie deal. Charlie doesn't know about it. And he finds out by accident through the interviewer that Frank is basically going to go Hollywood. And then Charlie has this meltdown on TV, on live TV.
For people who may never have read the synopsis of this show, this can get so confusing because, again, it is kind of different scene to scene, depending on what version you're talking about. But the whole conceit here is that they have had written this show going left, turning left. I always forget what it's called, but that's the musical that they want to put on. But we're told it wasn't commercial. So Frank has kind of gone more the commercial side, has sold the rights to their actual popular musical to Hollywood. And now he's taking
musical
this
husbands.
Musical husbands. Yes, that's right.
Again, homoeroticism.
And now he's taking this new three-picture deal. So it keeps pushing back and back and back their opportunity to come back right together and push out this thing that they both were really passionate about at one time. It's more like Frank has decided to kick the can down the road for them to come back and do something of meaning rather than just going commercial and doing the thing that was probably going to make them a bunch of money. See, this is a hard part about this show, too, for me. Like, because I get that central conceit. And Frank absolutely is like an asshole through most of the first act of this show. I have a hard time because it does feel like there's this underlying message, it seems to be, is like, in order to make great art, you have to be struggling. And I don't know if I actually agree with that central premise. I get about the selling out part. Like, that is absolutely a different thing altogether. But it does also seem like what Charlie's point of view is like, you have to also be struggling in order to create great art. But I don't know if you agree with that, my reading into that.
There is a point where we'll talk about the lyrics here where Charlie has the opportunity to talk about the prioritization of money. And so maybe we'll be able to iron it out a little bit when we get into the lyrics.
Hey everyone, just Kyle breaking into the conversation to tell you about some of the people and organizations that help this show continue to go. First and foremost, if you'd like to help support the show for absolutely free, you can give a rating and review on whatever app you listen to podcasts in. That's, of course, greatly appreciated. And if you'd like to help monetarily, which will only help you grow and make the show better, you can do so over at our Patreon page. Please do not donate if it impacts you negatively financially. You can head on over, though, to patreon.com/puttingittogetherpodcast. Also need to give a huge thank you to the God That's Good tier from Patreon of Jack, Todd, Robert, Louise, Christopher, and Steven. And thank you so much to Derek for upping their contribution here this week. I am so thankful that you were able to do that. Put It Together is, of course, a proud member of the Alberta Podcast Network, locally grown, community supported. The Alberta Podcast Network promotes and supports Alberta-made podcasts and connects their audiences with Alberta-based businesses and organizations. This week, we're brought to you by Connect First Credit Union, who does have a pre-recorded message. Let's go listen to that now.
Do you ever feel like just a number? A digit? A denominator? A decimal? Another cog in the big bank machine? Waiting on hold? Online, never on time, and always on your dime. Like your worth is only calculated by your net worth. In a world full of numbers, it's nice to know there's a place where you're not one. Connect First Credit Union. Bank on a brighter future.
This week, we're also brought to you by Alberta Blue Cross. You know, even if you're a busy business owner with more meetings and hours in a day, you are calm and collected when your group benefit plan is taken care of by Alberta Blue Cross. Your employees can manage their own health, dental, life, and disability coverage online, anytime, on any device, making it easier for them and for you. To learn more and explore your options, head on over to ab.bluecross.ca. Let's jump into this. I warned you, you know, right before we started recording that I'm going to have to kind of perform this as much as I possibly can. I often call myself a triple non-threat because I can't sing, dance, or act. So I'll try my best at going through these. To set the stage, whoever the interviewer happens to be normally opens this up by asking either Charlie directly or the both of them that are sitting together, how do you two work together? And Charlie breaks in going like, wait, can I answer that? How do we work together? He goes, plinkety, plinkety, plink, as if mimicking a piano.
And in the score, there is an arpeggio played.
Yes, that's right. And it's like, and I go, clickety, clickety, clack, which is usually a typewriter that's being sounded at this point. And then he goes, and soon we're humming along. Mm-hmm, and that's called writing a song. Mm-hmm. Then he goes, plinkety, plinkety, plink. And I go, clickety, clackety, clack. And the phone goes, dring. And he goes, mutter, 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 mutter. Yes, Jerome. Mutter, mutter, no, Jerome. Mutter, 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 mutter. That's his lawyer, Jerome. Mutter, 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 mutter. Do it, Jerome. Sorry, Charlie. And then he goes back and plays the arpeggio. So I go, clickety, clickety, clack. And he goes, plinkety, plinkety, plink. And I go,
now tell me, how do you two work together?
Oh, may I answer that?
Please.
How do we work together? Sure. He goes, and I go, and soon we're humming along, and that's called writing a song. Then he goes, and I go, and the phone goes, and he goes, mutter, 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 yes, Jerome, mutter, no, Jerome, mutter, 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 that's his lawyer, Jerome, mutter, 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 do it, Jerome, click, sorry, Charlie. So I go, and he goes.
Well, it's a really clever use of sound here between the piano and the typewriter, because it's reflective. It, you know, the piano and the typewriter are the mechanical avatar, you know, stand-ins for Charlie and Frank in a scene that we are actually depicting in our head. This is a one, again, sort of going back to what's fun in a literary way about the show is that we've arrived back at 1973, and now we're going to get this song as a delivery of what's happened between 1968 and 1973. And Charlie's basically going to sum up what's happened to their working relationship. And the way it's being conveyed here, again, is through the piano and the typewriter. It's an interesting way to tell a story.
And it has been set up a little bit here too, right? I can't remember if it's in the original or not. I think it is, but definitely in the revised version, the opening scene, they mentioned this. It's like, there was this famous interview. Don't you remember the famous interview that Charlie Kringis gave? So we're kind of being set up to know, like, oh, there's going to be something going on here that he's going to overstep his bounds.
Oh, and the third mechanism here is of course, the Charlie making the sound of the telephone. You know, there was a one of the episodes of your podcast I listened to recently where somebody was talking about how percussion is part of the story and that people don't always necessarily realize the importance of percussion. And here we have the piano, the typewriter, and at least the sound of the telephone all kind of working, the imitation of the telephone working together to create, to tell a story and actually to recall a story of what it's like in the workplace.
I mean, this is such an actory song. You could have so much fun, like really digging into this and developing like how you want each of these things to sound like if you're going to be verbalizing with your mouth. I could also see like you're actually having some sort of percussive elements on stage and playing around with that as well, like if you wanted to.
Yeah, I mean, well, I've listened to recordings of this song where instead of using the sound of a typewriter, the drummer is actually playing out the rhythm of the typewriter on the edge of the snare. And as for the actory parts of this, yeah, it's fun to go back and listen to different versions of this. The actor who originally did this on Broadway was Lonnie Price.
That's right.
If you look at the lyrics from the Sondheim book, the sound of the telephone that he's making is written out as during with a D. There's some other version of this online where it's burring with a B.
That's right.
But I swear that anybody can DM me if they disagree with this. I swear later in the song that in Lonnie Price's version that he starts saying gurring with a G to make it sound like an angry animal or something.
Okay.
That's what I hear when I was doing is gurring. But that's, again, that's a little later in this recording.
Just as an aside, I really love how Lonnie Price performs this song. I think he's great. I mean, a lot of times the original cast has just the opportunity to be workshopping this for so long that it really feels like a part of them. But do you have a favorite version of the song by any chance?
Again, this version from the original 1981 cast with Lonnie Price was my first exposure to it. I've heard other people on your podcast talk about a kind of a bias they get from their original experience with the cast album was, and I just love Lonnie Price on this. He's Lonnie Priceless. And you can find other versions of this either that are recorded or performed on YouTube. And this is always going to be this original Lonnie Price version is always going to be the one that I measure everybody else by. For the most part, I feel like others are good, but not as good as this. I'll give you two possible exceptions. One is, I don't know if you've had the opportunity to watch the Chocolate Factory version of this from the 2013. It's a film version.
Yes, I have.
Okay.
Yeah.
That Charlie Kringis is really good. I like him. And the other one I would recommend to people, if you really want to take a deep dive on this, is go to YouTube. There's a version of the show. I think it's from the early 2000s with Raul Esparza. It's at some theater company. I think it was done in Washington, maybe the Kennedy Center, something like that. And Esparza, I'm going to give him credit for being the most different than Lonnie Price than any other version I've heard. He really puts his own thing into it, and it's a lot of fun to see how he gives it the Raul Esparza treatment.
Well, we continue on here as Charlie goes, and soon we're tapping away. Mm-hmm. Bzz, sorry, Charlie. Bzz, it's a secretary. Bzz, on the intercom. Yes, Miss Bzz, it's a messenger. Thanks, Miss Bzz. Will you tell him to wait? Will you order the car? Will you call up the bank? Will you wire the coast? Will you dring? Sorry, Charlie. Mutter, 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 sell the stock. Mutter, buy the rights. Mutter, 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 mutter. Bzz, let me put you on hold. Bzz, yes, Miss Bzz, it's the interview. Thanks, Miss Bzz. Will you tell him to wait? Will you wire the car? Will you order the coast? Will you set up the bank?
And soon we're tapping away. Sorry, Charlie. It's the secretary. On the intercom. Yes, Miss Bzz, it's a messenger. Thanks, Miss Bzz. Will you tell him to wait? Will you order the car? Will you call up the bank? Will you wire the coast? Will you ring? Sorry, Charlie. Mutter, 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 sell the stock. Mutter, buy the rights. Mutter, 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 Bzz. Let me put you on hold. Yes, Miss Bzz, it's the interview. Thanks, Miss Bzz. Will you tell him to wait? Will you wire the car? Will you order the coast? Will you send up the bank?
Two things here. One is, again, depending on where you're getting the text of your lyrics from, sometimes it's written out as Miss Bzz, B-Z-Z, but I found it written as Miss Bzz, B-I-Z-Z, shorthand for as if he's saying Miss Business. The other thing I wanted to ask you, because I don't know if you're old enough or if you came from a place where you would be familiar with the origin of Sorry, Charlie.
Oh, no, I guess not. Yeah, not at all.
So where I grew up, we had there were television commercials all the time on TV. I animated commercials for Star-Kissed Tuna, and their mascot for years was Charlie Tuna. And this, as far as I can tell, starting back in the 1960s, is the origin of the popular phrase, Sorry, Charlie.
I know what that is, Charlie.
Yeah, what is it?
A modern statue.
Yeah, you looked at the label.
What you doing with it, Charlie?
Sending it to Starkist so they'll notice what good taste I got.
They can tell from that?
Of course, dummy. They know that only guys with real good taste can stand to be around this junk.
That makes sense. That makes sense. But, Charlie, they ain't exactly looking for tunas with good taste. Starkist wants tunas that taste good.
Nah, here they come. Can you see it from up there?
Sorry, Charlie, but only the best-tasting tuna get to be Starkist.
And if there are older people out there who want to dispute that, I'd love to hear about it. As far as I can tell, people started saying Charlie Charlie after the 1960s. Again, you can go on YouTube and find these old TV commercials. Charlie was voiced for decades by Herschel Bernardi, the Tony Award winning actor for Zorba. He did Tevye on Broadway. He was the voice of Charlie Tuna. The reason why I think it's worth bringing up, and maybe you'll find this a stretch, is because the gag of these tuna fish commercials was that Charlie the Tuna was always trying to get the attention of Starkist Tuna because he wanted to become a star. And so he was going, he would put on all these sort of staged antics to try and get the attention of Starkist Tuna. And at the end, there'd be a hook, but instead of taking the hook, there was a sign on it that said, "Sorry, Charlie." The reason I think this is interesting is because I'm just wondering if at some level Sondheim wasn't sort of picking up on this gag that Charlie Tuna in this case, is too dumb to realize that the hook would be taking him away to be eaten. And that's what I'm putting out here is a little parallel between the disappointments of fame and success that happened not to our Charlie, but to Frank, is that he doesn't necessarily see that once he does get caught by the tuna fish company, that what's going to happen to him in the end. So is that a stretch? I don't know.
No, I think there probably may be some sort of allusion to that. I think we're missing an opportunity. They should have adapted this into an animated movie with sardines and just made that very, very clear.
I wish they had. If you listen to Lonnie Price, I think he's still saying, "Sorry, Charlie," the way that we did back in the 70s and 80s with a reference back to this TV commercial. If you listen to or watch later productions, the actors don't necessarily pick up on it.
Oh, interesting. The other thing I was going to point out here, which I think is so funny, pretty great lyric writing, just to show Charlie becoming more and more frazzled as this interview goes on, but how he flips the words, right? Because it's first, order the car, call up the bank, wire the coast. And then it's wire the car, order the coast, send up the bank.
Right.
So he's getting them all, the words all mixed up.
Yeah. I don't necessarily find any meaning in the mix up of those words.
No.
I mean, yeah, send up the bank doesn't really mean anything, does it?
Not that I'm aware, but maybe someone can write in and say, like, no, this is it's this other 1960s commercial that you don't know about.
Okay. No. You may have been planning to talk about this a little bit later, but I'll mention it now,
sure.
Which is Stephen Sondheim's comments about modular furniture.
Yeah, go ahead. Talk about it.
It's interesting. He talks about how he wrote this whole show a little bit differently in the sense that there are themes, releases, reprises, fragments of songs of songs that get repeated all through the show.
Yes.
And careful listening to the show, you start to figure out, oh, that comes from somewhere else. I remember that. And it happens all over the place.
Yeah, it is remarkable. Having done my deep dive here the last couple of weeks and listening to a bunch of different versions kind of on repeat, my big shame here is that Merrily was actually one of the very last Sondheim shows, like, really, that I started listening to or getting into. When you first have to go through that score repeatedly, it's like, oh my god, this thing is here. Oh, and this thing is over here. Like, you keep hearing these things get, like, referenced before the song comes, or it's like a callback, and then this is a call forward. Like, it is very much intentional throughout this entire show. Like, these little themes that are dropped in here and there to kind of set you up for later in the show.
Themes and lyrics, too.
Yes.
And there's a couple of things coming up here that I'll bring up that, again, I think are part of Sondheim's idea about furniture that you kind of move around and put into different shapes to create a new setting. And he's doing that both musically and lyrically.
Yeah, there actually is maybe something that I can reference here, like, coming up. So the next few lyrics are this: "And the telephone blinks and the stocks get sold and the rest of us he keeps on hold and he's into making movies and he's now a corporation. Right? So I play at home with my wife and kids and I want to hear the movie bids and I've got a little sailboat and I'm into meditation. Right? He flies off to California. I discuss him with my shrink. That's the story of the way we work, me and Franklin Shepard Inc.
And the telephones blink and the stocks get sold and the rest of us he keeps on hold and he's going to start producing and he's now a corporation. Right? And I play at home with my wife and kids and I wait to hear the movie bids and I got a little sailboat and I'm in a meditation. Right. He flies off to California. I discuss him with my shrink. That's the story of the way we work, me and Franklin Shepard, Inc.
The thing I always wanted to bring up is Charlie's repeated going of right, which he does actually kind of use in different ways. It's like sometimes he's actually asking it, and sometimes I think it's just a filler word that he's using. But that also gets brought up in Now You Know as well.
Yeah, that right is this song. I'm not a musical expert, and maybe some of your good guests who have more experience with musicology could talk about it. I think the closest relative to Franklin Shepard, Inc. is actually Now You Know, both tonally and lyrically. And that right comes up in very much the same way.
That's the thing, too, about the Charlie character is that going back to the Kaufman and Hart play, I think it's much more delved into there than it is in this show, but how Charlie almost blames himself a little bit for Frank going this route, because he's the one who pushes him onto that boat after the divorce trial. And I think he really thinks like, oh, if only we had kept him here with Mary and myself, things may have changed trajectory a little bit.
Yeah, I think at least in the revised version, there's a line with Mary also kind of blaming Charlie for pushing Frank onto the boat, not off the boat.
Right. This is another aside here too, just because again, you're one of the first people I'm doing a recording session with. Do you know why they changed the names of the characters?
You mean from the original play to this?
Yes.
I don't know why. I don't know if it's an issue with the Kaufman or Hart estate, and they were like, well, you can use the name and the idea, but you can't use the names of the characters. It's just a guess.
Anyways, coming back to this, anything we want to say about these lyrics any more than we have so far?
No, I think I'm ready for the next section.
I do want to just call out to how much I love how many rhymes Sondheim actually gets for ink. it starts here because we get blink, shrink, but we'll keep adding on to those as we go through this entire song.
Right.
So we come back to basically a Bookstein here, right? You know, I've always asked this question, which is like, as Sondheim has said in other interviews, like his most hated question, which is like, what comes first, the music or the lyrics? And it's like the contract. And then the interviewer is usually at this point being like, it sounds like you don't like making money, or you think that money is a bad thing for an artist. Charlie goes, did I say money? No, I like money a lot. I mean, it's better than not. But when it's money, 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 when you're into money, and you should be, playing that arpeggio. Listen, Frank does the money thing very well. And you know what? There are people who do it better. And Frank does the music thing very well. And you know what? Nobody does it better.
The contract.
Well, that sounds like you think making money is a bad thing for an artist.
Money? Did I say money? No, I like money a lot. I mean, it's better than not. But when it's money, money, when you're into money, and you should be. Listen. Frank does the money thing very well. But you know what? Other people do it better. And Frank does the music thing very well. And you know what? No one does it better. Still, the telephone's blinking.
I want to ask about your, if you have an opinion about, well, not the rhyme of lot and not, but the structure of that phrase. Because it says, I like money a lot. And then it's better than not. So technically we're missing a verb here. And it used to drive me crazy. I thought it was just a rhyme for the sake of rhyming, but I'm over it now. I'm just wondering if you've given it any thought.
This part doesn't bother me. Oh, I'm blanking. There is actually another song in this show, and I'll mention it when we actually get there, because I can't remember where it is now. That I actually have a similar issue where it's like, oh, he's phrased this in a weird way to make it be a rhyme. This is, of course, Charlie's laugh line. Like, people are supposed to be like, oh, yeah, that's pretty funny. But yeah, no, it's never really super bothered me, that part.
What I sort of decided that what was actually happening here, that this wasn't a mistake on Sondheim's behalf, this is actually part of his genius, that what he's doing here is actually referencing the type of lyric that would have been written were this being performed, were this written by a Lorenz Hart or Ira Gershwin or Yip Harburg or somebody. He's including here of the type of rhyme that would have been in a song had this been the 1930s. That's what I've decided is actually happening in this particular rhyme structure.
Yeah, and he goes into that a little bit. You actually even see it in the documentary that's made about the making of Merrily We Roll Along that Lonnie Price himself actually directed. I always feel like Sondheim was like making things harder for himself than he needed to, because I think you're right. He says in that he was trying to emulate the time period, but also he was trying to emulate what he would have written in his mid-20s. And I think that's just an extra level of hardship that he's throwing at himself, of him trying to write as his younger self, but in the style of a 1930s musical, which is just like, I don't even know how you even begin to try and do that. The biggest thing from here, this is actually mostly booksy. Like, Sondheim did not write like the spoken bits here, of course. That would have been George Firth in this case. But just to pick this apart just a little bit here, obviously, Charlie, as he mentions explicitly here, it's not that he's afraid of people making money. He's afraid of just hoarding money.
Or making decisions based on money alone. Mm-hmm. And this goes back to something that you asked me a little earlier in the podcast. And this was specifically what I was thinking about, was Charlie was not averse to the comforts of becoming either a recognized or famous artist, as far as being able to have a sailboat and play with his kids and that sort of thing. I don't think that the characters believes 100% that in a sort of ascetic life of a writer or an artist versus the life of somebody who creates things for commercial purposes. What he's saying here is that Frank is a pig.
Right. Well, what it actually reminds me of, there's not that I'm a super religious person by any stretch of the imagination, but there is that quote from the Bible that's actually usually misquoted. Money is the root of all evil. But that's not what the whole line is. It's the love of money is the root of all evil. That's what what's the whole line is. Yeah. And that's basically what he's saying here, right? So it's not money that's the evil thing. It's the love of money that is the evil thing.
It's also the way that Charlie is treating people. I'm sorry, not Charlie. It's the way that Frank is treating people in his life, whether it be treating his friendships with Charlie and Mary, or treating his wives, that it's not just that he is a pig for money. He's a boar for attention and the accolades that come with, in this case, becoming a Hollywood producer.
Oh, and that is the other thing too that I think I missed talking about here, is that the lyrics where he says, and he's into making movies, and he's now a corporation. That's not what the original Broadway cast sings. They say, and he's going to start producing, and now he's a corporation. That's what he says. So they make it very blunt. That's the producing side of things.
As opposed to being like a film director.
Right, right. Which it does sound like that is what Frank wants to be doing, but is not quite what he's doing yet. He hasn't become a director yet. He's just that producer. I think the biggest thing is that this is one of the improvements I think that the musical does on that Kaufman and Hart play, because again, I actually think that the Charlie character, his name is Jonathan in that play, is much more into like money, making money is bad. Like that really feels like what that character is there to say in that show, and then essentially disappears for half of it. Like he's not really even in most of the rest of the show.
Right. We should mention that the character in the Kaufman Hart play is a painter.
They don't work together, right?
Yeah. Yeah, right. They're friends, but they're not partners in art.
Mm-hmm. Charlie continues going on and says, still the telephones blink and the buzzers buzz, and I really don't know what he does, but he makes a ton of money, and a lot of it for me, right? So I think okay, and I start a play, and he somehow knows, because right away it's during. Hiya, buddy, want to write a show? Got a great idea. We'll own all the rights with a 2-week out and a turnaround on the guarantee plus a gross percent of the billing clause. And there I am in California, talking deals and turning pink. Back in business, and I mean just that, back with Franklin Shepard Inc. Very sneaky how it happens. Much more sneaky than you think. Start with nothing but a song to sing. Next, you're Franklin Shepard.
Still the telephones blink and the buzzers buzz, and I really don't know what he does, but he makes a ton of money, and a lot of it for me. right? So I think okay, and I start a play, and he somehow knows, cause right away it's dring. Hiya, buddy, wanna write a show? Got a great idea, we'll own all the rights with a 2-week out and a turnaround on the guarantee, plus a gross percent of the billing clause, and there I am in California, talking deals and turning pink. Back in business, and I mean just that, back with Franklin Shepard, Inc. Very sneaky how it happens, much more sneaky than you think. Start with nothing but a song to sing. Next year, Franklin Shepard. Wait a second, wait.
I'm getting a couple of things that catch my eye on this section. One is, I love the phrasing of a gross percent of the billing clause, because yeah, gross right. is being used cleverly here.
Right.
Because gross is obviously within the context of this phrase. Gross is a term used in business, but Charlie is also using it as a description of his opinion about how much money is being made. Billing clause is only interesting to me because in previous life working in finance, I'm not sure what exactly he means by billing clause.
Sure.
Or why you would get a percentage of the billing clause, but I shouldn't argue that too much. I'm more interested, actually, I wanted to ask you I want to ask you about turning pink.
Yeah, and okay.
Does that phrase mean anything to you?
Well, I mean, I think what we're supposed to take from it, like the literal meaning, is that he's getting sunburned, is what I think, because he's out in the California sun, and he's a pasty man. But, I mean, I'm also sure that there's double meanings. He, like, throughout this song, like, you just brought out the gross part of it, right? And Miss Biz and that sort of thing. I think there's all these words that he is very cleverly using to be like, here's the actual meaning, but there's also this other hidden meaning that you could read into this.
Okay, you know what? I didn't even make a connection between the California part and his skin mm-hmm. turning pink. What I saw out of this was that it was pink in the sense that he was either embarrassed or angry, and he wasn't quite red yet. He wasn't, you know, like mm. I'm turning, you know, like somebody who gets angry, their face turns red. And because this is sort of a Charlie's anger and is building in this song, and at this point in his retelling of the story, he's up to pink, but he's not quite red mad yet.
You could also read this, I guess this is up to the actor to interpret it, like what I just said there, turning pink as if getting a sunburn is maybe probably what the actual intention was. But this entire song is basically him being like, I'm embarrassed by what uh-huh. Frank is doing. And I think that this could be read as part of that, right? Like, I'm here, I'm talking these deals about these moves I don't care about, and I'm just embarrassed to be a part of this yeah. meeting in the first place.
Uh-huh. Yeah, that I think that could be another interpretation of pink here, too. That was just a suggestion. Mm-hmm. I thought about, well, could pink mean something about homosexuality? Could it mean something about communism? You could stretch mm-hmm. the point for him to be saying about either of those two things also. But I like your revelation here that this is actually about his skin turning pink under the right. California sun.
By the way, pink, of course, is something else that is rhyming with ink, along yep. with think and blink. Just quickly going back to the billing clause idea, this does make it sound, this feels very much like someone trying to sound like a business person without actually sure. understanding, knowing what the actual phrases are. But I also have this understanding. I know Sondheim was the first to be like, listen, well, actually, this show is like the counterexample to this, because he comes right out and says, like, two of these songs are semi-autobiographical, or at least I use part of my own history to write the song. But this does feel like something that he probably overheard and was like, I don't care about the business stuff. I have other people that do this for me. Right. Sondheim seemed to be like the person that just never wanted to have those discussions. He'd rather just, you know, plink away or write sleeping on his couch.
Right. Pay attention here to very sneaky how it happens, because we're going to get a bunch of happens here throughout the rest of the song that that are used cleverly to describe how things do or don't happen, or what the consequences of something happening are. So I just wanted to make sure that we fit that in.
Well, yeah, I mean, and that is really the setup here, right? Because the song slows down. And it's like, and he's describing himself here with Frank. They started with this one song that they wrote together that they're super proud of. And before he really knew what had happened, they're a business, right? They are this entity, this thing is pumping out hits that maybe Charlie himself is not super, super happy with. There's this kind of longer book scene. I don't have the exact text here in front of me, but this, I believe, is the part where he's like, listen, we haven't made this official break here yet. Like, why we need to get back. I miss being together, right? Like, I miss that feeling of you and me working together. And he sings, nothing permanent has happened, just a temporary kink. Friendship's something you don't really lose. And then he usually makes this plea of like, hey, people, like, write this guy to tell him to get back to doing what he does best, which is writing music. Very sneaky how it happens. Every day you're on the brink. First the prizes, then the interviews.
Look, nothing permanent has happened. Just a temporary kink. Friendship's something you don't really lose. Very sneaky how it happens. Every day you're on the brink. First the prizes, then the interviews.
And that's usually when he snaps out of it and realizes, oh my God, I'm back here in the studio. I'd forgotten where I was.
Well, as I mentioned a second ago, we had, in the previous section, we had very sneaky how it happens. Then in after the dialogue piece, we have nothing permanent has happened. And mm-hmm. again, if we're going by the flow of the book from the original stage show, what we know has happened, because we're going backwards in time right here, is that Frank has already had this piece of dialogue where he says that he's never going to speak. Well, he's going to pretend like Charlie never existed. In, I think I've got this right, in the revised version of this show, that little Frank speech actually happens after this song.
Right. Yeah. They kind of move it around. Because I just remembered, it's like the whole thing of like friendship is like a garden, I think, is like the part that he's talking about here.
Right. Exactly. So I just wanted to point out there that's the next instance of the word happen being used here. And it's with Charlie saying nothing permanent has happened. And what we know that Charlie doesn't know is that something permanent has happened, that they aren't speaking together anymore. Or that.
Well, I mean, you've called it here a few times. And now you know, the song Now You Know has that whole break of like, best thing that ever could have happened, right?
Best thing that ever could have happened. Yeah, again, another use of that word. And that's a callback. When you get to this in your series,
right?
There's that relationship between that song specifically, Now You Know, and this one, and I found that too.
Mm-hmm. Kink and brink, of course, are the two new words that are rhyming with ink. So I think we're up to six or seven words that he's using in his like long line of rhymes. The one that I want to bring up here is really lose and interviews. That's what he's rhyming in this. Which is fun. Here's how the song ends here, though. Oh my God, I think it's happened. Stop me quick before I sink. One more triumph that I can't refuse. In case you didn't notice, this is my first time on TV and my last. No, here's the point, whatever happens, then we'll all go have a drink. That's the guy I love, the fellow who's inside. Mutter, 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 quick, Jerome, get the president. There's a crazy man on my TV screen. Inside, bzz, bzz, during, inside, Franklin Shepard. Just write him care of any bank, USA, Inc.
Oh my God, I think it's happened. Stop me quick before I sink. One more triumph that I can't refuse. In case you didn't notice, this is my first time on TV and my last. No, here's the point, whatever happens, then we'll all go have a drink. That's the guy I love, the fella who's inside. Money, 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 quick, Jerome, get the president. There's a crazy man on my TV screen.
First line of this section is the next instance of
right.
happened, which is, oh my God, I think it's happened. And this is following where Charlie says something about prizes and interviews. And he's right. in the middle of an interview when he's talking about how he hates the interviews. And so
because right, it leads you to wanting more fame, more money, more everything.
Right. So he's looking around and then he's realizing that he's once again, sort of like been walked into an uncomfortable situation, sort of like we were talking about when he was in his experiences in California, where he's getting away from what he wants to be doing and focusing on all these sort of superficial things like prizes and mm-hmm. interviews. So we've gone from it's sneaky how it happens to nothing permanent has happened to, oh my God, I think it's happened, meaning it's happened again. And he's gone from a little sort of like break in the song where he's talking about friendship and how you have to treat friendship like a garden and all this. And mm-hmm. he's realizing that he is the one who is always trying to hold this. He, in his mind, he's the one who's trying to hold this relationship together. And at this point, he feels like he's kind of a sucker. And oh my God, it's happened again.
You know what's fascinating too? I'm just looking at these lyrics here now, and this fits into one of the themes of the show even. He keeps flipping essentially tenses, right? So like nothing permanent has happened. We're talking about the past. Very sneaky how it happens. We're talking about the present. Oh my God, I think it's happened. Whatever happens is what he's going to say next. So now we're going into the future. Like he's going through past, present, future within these lyrics as well. Using
yeah,
happens.
Absolutely. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And it gets down to this last whatever happens, again, not knowing that he's about to be ordered out of Frank's life. And he thinks that this is all going to be water under the bridge, and that because of his whatever previous experience he had with being angry at Frank, that they'll patch things up and go have a drink. And mm-hmm. he doesn't necessarily know that something permanent has happened.
Right. Yeah. And that's basically how this scene gets wrapped up. After the song ends, this is where Frank says, no, we're done. You're out of my life. I'm never talking to you ever again. The last two rhymes with ink, we have sink and drink, which is fun. But the other rhyme that I love here is I can't refuse with the fella who's. And then we also get, again, that percussive element here at the very end, like bzz, bzz, dring. I always find this ending bit thrilling. I don't care who it is that performs it. I just love how like the orchestra behind them has been kind of like rising in tempo and volume. And so it's like this last flurry of him just being like kind of frantic.
Right. It happens right after that. Oh, my mm-hmm. God, I think it's happened. And from that point right. forward, it just kind of loses control. And you've talked many times and your guests have talked many times on this show about characters losing their mind.
Yeah. Well, Simon even writes about that. He's like, I didn't notice how many songs I've written about people having mental breakdowns until I put these lyrics together. But he does such a good job of it. He's able to internalize what those emotions feel like into verbal language that he's able to communicate with so effectively. So within the long line of great breakdown songs, I would say.
It's another type of song, too, in the sense that it is not just a breakdown song, but a takedown song.
Mm, right.
I was really trying to think of other examples from Broadway history where you have characters who are not just angry or not just telling the audience about, having an epiphany before the audience about how angry they are. This is literally one character, a character on stage assassinating another character's behavior or personality. The closest thing that I can actually think of to this would be Could I Leave You from from Follies.
Right.
But I'd love to hear if people can think of other examples of where in a Broadway show where a character really addresses someone face to face with this kind of disappointment and anger.
Well, thank you so much for joining me here today. I mean, there's a few things I want to ask. Number one, for this song in particular, do you feel like this is like top five, middle five, bottom five? Like, where would you rate this in the score of Merrily We Roll Along?
Okay, well, I'm a big fan of your podcast, and so I knew this question was coming, and I actually ranked all of the songs.
Okay, good.
And I put Franklin Shepard, Inc. at number two.
Okay.
In my overall list.
What's your top five?
I'll give you my top five in reverse order.
Great.
Number five is Merrily We Roll Along, the sort of theme music. Number four is Bobby and Jackie and Jack.
Okay.
Which I could talk about for hours. Three is Opening Doors, which I also love. Two, Franklin Shepard Inc. And my favorite is the last song of the show, Our Time.
Yeah. Maybe I should compile mine as we go through this here too. The question I'm asking to every guest here this season to kind of tie into the theme a little bit is that if you were given a time machine and you could go back in time, what is the show? It doesn't have to be a Sondheim show, but what show would it be that you would want to go to and see on Broadway?
Can it be a show that I've never seen, right?
Yeah, a show you've never seen.
I really, really want to see Jamaica.
Oh, my God. Okay.
I think it's 56 or 57, the Yip Harburg show starring Ricardo Montalban and Lena Horne. It's one of my favorite, it's my favorite scores to listen to. I think it's really funny. I'm afraid to find out that the show is super racist.
Okay. Right.
But I'd like to see it. And I don't know if they've ever done it on New York Encores or not.
Like Encores, yeah.
Yeah. I'd like to go back in time and see the original production with Lena Horne.
That's cool. I love that answer. That's awesome. Richard, if people wanted to stay in contact with you or see what you're up to, what's the easiest way for them to do so online?
Best way to find me on Twitter or Instagram is at RF Brownwords, and that's words with an A, not an O. And I'm also a semi-regular guest on a movie podcast called Full Cast and Crew, where I'm periodically invited to come on and talk about what we call the new Hollywood movement of the 70s and 80s. Yeah.
Cool. Excellent. Thanks so much, Richard.
Absolutely. Thank you so much. It's been a lot of fun.
Thank you so much for listening. You can send emails to puttingittogetherpodcast@gmail.com. You can also follow Sondheim Podcast on Twitter and Instagram. And you can support the show on Patreon by going to patreon.com/puttingittogetherpodcast. Thank you to the Alberta Podcast Network, to Connect First Credit Union, and to Alberta Blue Cross this week. Putting It Together is available on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Spotify, and pretty much anywhere you can get podcasts from. Consider subscribing so that you never miss an episode. Next week, we're going to be talking about old friends. What do you say, old friends? As always, a big thank you to the great Chris Taniguchi, who designed the podcast artwork, and to Nick Driscoll for composing our theme music. Well, we've reached the end of our episode. Yes, I know. Goodbye for now.